Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room.
And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing.
See you all here. Glad you're here with us. It's November, but it is the first Sunday of Advent already. Can you believe it? Less than a month will be Christmas, and so I don't know about you guys, but I love this time of year, just as Christmas and celebrating Jesus coming to this world. Just blows my mind how God wrapped Himself in human flesh and gave us His one and only Son. And everything that comes with that. And so just excited that you guys are here. We finished our Acts study, and this morning we're going to do start a two-part series. So this week and next week on preparations. As we get close to Christmas, a lot of people have to do a lot of planning, and maybe they're visiting families or, you know, things like that. But we're going to talk about preparations that we need to make. So that'll be where we're going today. But why don't we go ahead and we'll pray, and then we'll do some worship. And then we've got a special little thing we're going to do in between our song set. You know how we were doing memory verses from the book of that went along with our Acts study. We're going to do something a little different, and it's going to involve the kids. And so hopefully that'll be a lot of fun. So anyway, let's go ahead and pray, and we'll get started. God, thank you so much for this day. Lord, we just think of the words of that song, Joy to the World. Lord, you knew without Jesus, we couldn't experience that true joy in you. And so you came to this earth to give us joy. And just like it says in the song, prepare him room. Lord, I pray, God, this morning that we would open our hearts and that there would be room for you, just to move and work in us. Lord, teach us, encourage us, fill us. Lord, we're just grateful again just to be here and celebrate who you are, God. We know there's something bigger than just humans. And a lot of people in the world are just trying to figure that out. And Lord, we know it's you. Your scripture tells us. It's all about you, not about us. And so no matter what kind of week we've had, whether it's been stressful, discouraging, rough, way too busy, whatever it's been, Lord, I pray, God, that you would just encourage us and prepare us for the week ahead from your scripture this morning. And so, God, we love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. At this time, I'm going to ask all of the kids, maybe up through standard 5, standard 6, you know, that age range, come on up here. And if you got a little one, you can come up with them. But I'm going to ask you guys to come sit right here on the floor. And I just want to read you something. Don't be bashful. Come on up here. Come on up here. We got something special we're going to do. So, yeah, come on. It's children's time. Come on up. Come on up. We got this little story for you. Yep. Come on up. 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 All right, so I'm going to ask you guys to grab out some Play-Doh. Mm-hmm. Whoopsie, that one. Go ahead and take some Play-Doh. Make sure everybody has some. Yep, we got any more kids that want to come up and join us? Anybody? Anybody out there? We got room up here. Woo. All right, so yeah, go ahead and break it out. Yep, break it out. Yeah, there's a little wrap. You might have to get some help there. Yeah, come on up. All right. Yeah, you can pull this chair. Yeah, you want to sit right there in the chair? There you go. Awesome. Yep, just pop that. There's a little saran wrap on it, so you got to pop that thing off there. Boy, they make it hard to get this Play-Doh. How'd you guys do that? Wow, this is tough stuff. Stab it with your finger. There it is, I got it. Who's got green? Got that one, Angela? All right. Yeah, all right. So yeah, go ahead. I want you to, as you're listening to our story, I want you to start making something, whatever you want it to be. It's your own creation, all right? Nobody's gonna judge it. It's just gonna be your own creation. Can you help? What help? Here, I'll help. All right. There we go. Got it? All right, very good. Yeah, come on up. Grayson, yeah, come on up. All right, so, oh yeah, let's share some Play-Doh. We got some more Play-Doh in there? All right, here's one. You want to open that for me, KJ? All right. There we go. All right, so again, as you're listening to my story, make sure you're listening, but then make your own creation, okay? Make your own creation, whatever you want it to be, all right? Okay, here we go. This story is called Perfectly Planned and Created, all right? I love this verse. Isaiah 64:8 says, Lord, you are our Father. We are like clay, and you are the potter. Isn't that awesome? Your hands made us all. There you go. Wow, it's like, whoa, I didn't know it was going to... Man, look at this. Everybody's going to have green and blue hands. Oh, boy. That's lots of fun. All right. Yeah, it might stick to the floor, so. Yeah, this is fun. Wow. Man, you talk about messy. This is good stuff. Get our hands all messy and green and blue. All right, here we go. Ready? There are some pretty interesting and really weird animals that God's in God's creation. There are some weird animals. One of them is the camel. Have you ever met a camel in real life? Me neither. Me neither. With its thick, bushy eyebrows, long eyelashes, hump on its back, and big, floppy feet, the camel is not exactly the world's cutest creature. Let's put a couple of the camel pictures up here on the screen. You want to see our camel up here up on the screen? See it? Can you see this? Anna Joy, you see the camel up here? Look at the camel. Look at his big floppy feet, long eyelashes, bushy eyebrows. And what's that big thing on his back? A hump. A hump. Oh boy. You think this is one of God's cutest creatures? Probably not. But everything about it was perfectly planned and created by God to help the camel live where? Where did the camel live? Where's the camel live? In the desert. In the desert. Not the dessert. The desert, right? Yeah, so here he is in the desert. God created perfectly for the desert. Are you guys creating your own thing? Like, you know, your own creation here? This is going to be cool. Let's see what they're going to be. All right, so that big hump that you see there, most people think it stores water. But actually, it stores what? Any ideas? Fat. Wow, that's a big fat thing right on the back of it, right? That big hump of fat lets the camel go up to a week without drinking water during the summer, and it can go even longer without eating. You know how? The camel can burn the fat in the hump, both energy and water. So what about those bushy eyebrows and long eyelashes? What do you think that does? It keeps the sand out of its eyes in the desert, right? Yeah, camels can even close their nostrils to keep out the sand. And those big floppy feet, they're perfect for traveling long distances on shifting sands. Yes, camels were perfectly planned and created to live in the desert. Just as fish were perfectly created to live in water, birds were perfectly created to fly, and monkeys perfectly created to swing through the trees. And you were perfectly created to be you. Just as a potter shapes the clay into vessels she wants to make, God made you with a plan and for a purpose, to love him and to love others. And he gave you special talents and abilities so you could live out his purpose for you in a uniquely you kind of way that no one else can do. God is the perfect creator, and he created you according to his perfect plan. Wow. Isn't that cool? Did you know baby camels are born without any humps at all? They don't have them. Camels with one hump are called Arabian camels, and they live in the Middle East. But camels with two humps, do we have a picture of that? There it is, right there. The camel with two humps, they live in Asia, like in China, and Mongolia. So that's how you can tell where they live. All right. So perfectly planned and created. Let's see. What are some of the things that you guys came up with? What did you design? A happy what?
Sea urchin.
Sea urchin. Wow, that does look happy. Yes, it's very cool. Very cool. Yes, how about you? A bear. Very, very. A teddy bear, actually. Yes, very good. How about you? A what?
A sleeping lion.
Oh, boy. Don't wake him up in here. All right, how about you? Huh? A camel? All right, so he's making a camel over here. That's very cool. How about you? A hot dog bun. All right, you must be hungry. Yes, all right. What'd you make? Green slime. Is that what you made? Green slime? Yeah, how about you? A cat. All right, awesome. So we got some cool creations. Do you guys see that? God, like we are like the clay in his hands, and he made us each differently with different gifts and abilities, but he perfectly planned us the way he wanted us to be. All right? So what we're going to do after this, we're going to go ahead and clean up during our next couple of songs. But yes, I love making messes. Woo! So like I said, we are done the book of Acts. We've been on that journey since February. And now it's going to look a little different. If you don't mind, I'm going to sit here and speak. If you need a copy of God's Word, it's over there. That's the version we're going to be using, is the Bible's over there. If you want to grab a copy, that's where I'm going to be reading from. But I'm going to be jumping from Scripture to Scripture. It's not going to be up on the screen. So if you have your Bible, you can turn real fast. It's almost going to be... From verse to verse, talking about this, but preparations are so important in life, aren't they? It seems like we're always preparing for something, and then all of a sudden that's done, and we got to keep preparing for something else. And sometimes I've heard it put like, have you ever seen those people that are spinning plates? And it's amazing how they can spin the plates. But they have this one going and this one going, and then over here this one's got to keep going, and so you finally, sometimes it just feels like they all come crashing down, right? But again, preparation, you got to keep spinning those plates while something else is going. You got to be preparing for this and preparing for that. And so let me ask you this question: was there ever a time in your life where you felt totally unprepared for something? I don't know what it was. Just kind of go back in your memory and you're like, I remember that time. Maybe it was a test in school and you forgot to study and you forgot the test was going to be that day, and you get to the test and you're like, oh no, I forgot to study. And you're looking at the questions and you're going, oh, I don't have any idea what I'm doing on this test. Or maybe you were cooking something and you didn't have one of the ingredients. And you're like, oh, I don't have that. What am I going to do? You know, and you feel unprepared, right? You're cooking something. Or maybe it was a work project and you didn't have the right tools. Maybe you went out to do a project somewhere and you're thinking to yourself, oh, if I only had that tool, oh man, this would be so much easier, right? You felt unprepared. So hopefully you have that story in your mind of like something that happened to you. Have you ever run out of gas? All right, yeah. That's just not, you're not prepared, right? Or maybe you didn't look at the gas gauge in a while and you're like, oh man. So what do you do? What do you do in those situations? Because when you realize you're unprepared, there's just something inside you that it's like your heart sinks. And you're like, oh no. This is going to be bad, right? And this weird feeling is happening. And you start asking these questions, how am I going to do this? Or what am I going to do about this? And then you start thinking. You start thinking, okay, well, I could do this, and it could get me out of that, right? I could improvise, right? If you don't have a certain ingredient, well, maybe I can use this, and nobody will know. Right? And you start improvising, and maybe you start, you don't have that certain tool, so you use something different, and it's not the best thing, but it gets the job done, right? And so there's this feeling and this improvising, but you have this feeling of, oh, if I had only been prepared, things would have been a whole lot easier, a whole lot better for me. And so the definition... I don't know if you got that up there. You got that. The definition of the word preparation is this. All right, so we've been there. Preparation is so important, right? Definition is the action or process of making ready or being made ready. Okay, so it's the process. So now you're saying, Tim, we're supposed to enjoy the process? Well, yeah, we most think it's the end result that we are excited for. But guess what? There's a process in this. And part of the process is the amazing part that we can experience in preparation. And so And so many times in the preparation, though, we can get stressed. We can get upset, frustrated, you know, and instead of enjoying the process. But here it is. It's the action or process of making ready or being made ready. Well, the question is, for what? For what? Well, let's start turning this spiritually. Let's start talking about it. We've been talking about a whole lot of physical things that happen to us and earthly problems and things like this. But guess what? God's talking about spiritual things. And there's spiritual preparedness that we can do. And so I want us to look at some things a little bit. What is God doing with us? Okay, if he's preparing, what? I mean, God created Adam and Eve, right? And all this happened. And a lot of people think, we don't have any purpose. What's the purpose and meaning of life? So what is God doing with all of us? Is he preparing us for something? Like, what is this all about? What's God's great big plan? Well, the first thing is, he creates Adam and Eve, and things were good. But then we know the story, right? Adam and Eve, they both eat from the tree that God said, hey, don't eat from this. You can have everything in this garden. Everything except this one thing. This one thing. And guess what Adam and Eve do? They go right to it, right? Here it is, yay. And guess what? They get in trouble. They're tempted by the serpent. And they take the fruit, they eat it, and what happens? From that point on, sin entered into God's perfect creation. So now we have messed things up. And that's sin. And what is the definition of sin? Well, sin is anything you think, say, or do that goes against what God wants. And so God wanted them not to eat from this tree, and it would be disobedience. And what do? They eat from it. So from that point on, it's been like for humans, like this cancer that's been passed down from generation to even us today. And we... I'm telling you, you don't need to teach kids to disobey, do you? They just naturally do it, right? And us, it's just there's something about us that wants to go toward the wrong things. It's just it's just part, and that's that sin cancer that's kind of spiritually eating us up. So what is God doing with us, right? That's the question. What is God doing with us? Well, guess what? He wants to show us that he wants us back from that sin cancer and that he can actually heal us from that sin cancer. And that's the good news. That's a really cool thing. But how does he do that? How does he show us that we have hope and we have meaning in this life? Well, the first thing he uses is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit actually convicts us of sin. And, you know, have you ever had that thought in your mind? You're like, I know what I'm doing is wrong, but I'm going to do it anyway. I mean, I've had that this week. I don't know. Hopefully you guys are with me. I mean, there's always this thing that's like tempting us to do the wrong thing, but the Holy Spirit saying, hey, don't do that. Don't do that. And we either choose to obey or we don't, right? That's all. It's all part of us. But the Holy Spirit, for somebody that's not a Christian, the first thing the Holy Spirit is going to do is say, hey, there's something called sin that you have, and you need to have healing from that. You need to have salvation from that. You need to have forgiveness from that. Because we can't do enough good things to work and earn our way back to heaven. We just can't do it. And if we do think we can do that, then what did Jesus come and die on a cross, a cruel death? What did he do that for? We would then be saying, my good things that I do is better than what Jesus did on the cross. Well, I don't want to say that because I can't outdo that. I can't outdo what Jesus did on the cross. So by that example, what he did on the cross actually paid for our sin. So the first thing the Holy Spirit's going to do is convict you of sin and know that you need a Savior and show you that you need a Savior. So the first thing, let's put that up there. He's going to convict us, our hearts, of sin. John 16:7. Would you turn with me there? John 16:7. John 16. And just so You understand, I'm not making this stuff up. This is what Jesus said about the work of the Holy Spirit. What is the Holy Spirit's job going to be? John 16:7. It says this in John 16:7. But what I'm about to tell you is true. It is for your good that I'm going to go away. Unless I go away, the friend, okay, what's the word friend? What's interesting about that word there that you see? It's capitalized. So when we capitalize things, that usually means it's a name of somebody important. And that means what he's talking about is the Holy Spirit. The friend will not come to help you. But if I go, I will send him. And verse 8 says, when he comes, he will prove that the world's people are guilty, and he will prove their guilt concerning sin and godliness and judgment. Have you ever sinned and you just felt so guilty? Like, man, what I did was so wrong. Oh, terrible. And we hold on to that guilt, don't we? A lot of times we hold on to that. And you know what it is? It's like the, you know, the 5-gallon water jugs. I don't know if I shared this with you before. It sounds familiar that I may have said this. But anyway, the 5-gallon water jugs that we have, imagine that strapped to your back. And when you sin, oh man, the water is getting full and full. And man, could you imagine carrying 5 pounds of a water jug on top, on your back? That weighs you down, doesn't it? It weighs you down. But you know what God does? When he sent Jesus, he said, you know what I'm going to do for you? I'm going to turn that water jug upside down. But see, a lot of people out here don't experience forgiveness, don't experience grace. And so they're going around life carrying this 5-gallon water jug going, what's the meaning of life? What's the purpose? I have no hope for my life. And they're just carrying around all the weight of their sin. Until one day, the Holy Spirit convicts them of their sin and they realize there's hope. And they realize Jesus took all my sin on the cross. All I got to do is accept Christ as my Savior. He's going to turn that water jug upside down. Then I experience forgiveness, grace, love, mercy, the whole thing. And your life, I'm telling you, as a believer, I've experienced this and it's amazing. That's why they wrote the song, Amazing Grace, right? It's amazing what God does. But until then, people will look at Jesus, they'll look at the Bible, and the Bible even says that they'll look at the cross of Jesus as foolishness because they don't understand. But when you get it, you get it, and you feel a freedom. Guess what? The enemy is going to want to use guilt to keep you weighed down and weighed down day after day. Do you know why? Because the enemy is always going to want to point you to the past. But Jesus and the Holy Spirit actually with conviction is looking forward. Saying, hey, don't do that next time. You don't need to, and I'll help you. That's what the Holy Spirit says. I'll help you with this. And so he's looking forward. When we're actually looking at the past and staying like all heavy and down. So let's look at the future. So the first thing is that, you know, the Holy Spirit is going to convict us of our sin. Well, how do we respond to that? When we are convicted of our sin, how do we respond? We respond with repentance and baptism. That's what, when Peter was telling everybody about their sin in the book of Acts, the whole crowd was like, what do I do? We're cut to the heart. Man, you've spoken a message and you're saying I'm a sinner. What do I do now? You repent and be baptized. That's what Peter said. Simple enough. You repent means to turn. You say, Lord, I'm a sinner, and I need to turn to you. And I want to accept you as Savior. Thank you for your forgiveness, God. Thank you for your love, your grace. And I want to be saved by faith and trust. And that's what you do. You respond with repentance and then baptism. And then that's like your first meeting with Christ. It's like when Jen and I got married, we were standing there at the altar, and I was saying to this woman, I'm yours, you're mine, and for the rest of my life. That's a big decision. right? It's almost like that with Jesus. When you accept his forgiveness, his grace, and you become a believer in Jesus Christ, you're saying, boom, I commit, Lord, I surrender. Basically what I was doing was surrendering my life to hers. Say, hey, I'm gonna put you above me. Wow, because guess what? In our marriage, when I put myself above her, it doesn't work out so good. Things don't work out good. But when I'm sitting there looking at Jen and I'm saying this, and I'm saying, did I know everything there was to know about being a husband? I'm like, honey, you got the perfect husband. I had to learn every day how to be a better husband. And I still make mistakes, right? It's just like that with Christ. You start with, Lord, I'm sorry for the sin that I've caused, and I want to experience your saving grace. Thank you for loving me. I surrender to you. And then you learn how to become a Christian, how to be a Christ follower. Each and every day you're learning what it's like to walk with Jesus. That's what it's like. And so we respond with repentance and baptism, or we can just keep going our own way, carrying the weight of our own sin. Hopeless, meaningless, like what happens after we die, right? Not knowing. Some people just like to say we cease to exist. But then what's the purpose of life? What's the meaning of life? Right? We got to start considering these questions. They're deep questions. But to understand that we have a spiritual side. I mean, think about this. The world, you can go thousands of years ago and you can see how people are trying to deal with their spiritual side of things. I mean, here in the Mayan culture, we have ruins that we can go visit, and what are a lot of those ruins telling us? They were sacrificing humans. They were sacrificing animals. They were doing this and that, all to try and figure out their spiritual side of things. And go thousands of years before that, over in the Middle East. I mean, all sorts of idol worship and things like that. We're spiritual beings. To deny that is kind of foolish, because we are spiritual beings and we got to figure out that spiritual side of things. So let's go on. Next point we got. What is he getting us ready for? We talked about in the definition, preparing is getting us ready. But ready for what? What is he getting us ready for? Well, number one, is if we're a believer in Christ, we should live a life that reflects him. All right, so have you ever seen, I saw this video, I want to show this video up here. Have you ever seen these people that go in front of different windows or mirrors that are kind of distorted? Let me show you this video. This guy came across an interesting window and he got it on video of himself. Here he is. Says, I think I found the best windows ever. All right, look at him. Can you see that? I know, oh, there you go. Look at that. It's like his whole body is cut off. And he's loving this, right? He's taking a video of it. Look. It's hilarious. Look at that. All right, so now we got some pictures of kids in front of these distorted mirrors. You know how they're curved and they kind of look weird? So look at this kid's head. All right, next one. All right, this guy's got some powerful muscles right here because the mirror is showing him. Yeah. Wow, thought you had a bad hair day. Wow, this is rough. Next one. The giraffe kid, right? He's got this long neck, right? Looks like a giraffe. All right, next one. Oh, that's all of them? Okay, cool. So here's what, all right. See, the whole idea is when we reflect to somebody else, we need to look like Jesus. But if this is all messy and you know how kids are, right? They'll just, you know, they'll lick their fingers and they'll just like do all this. And guess what? Look at this. I mean, it just gets all messy. See, this is our sin. All right. So this is our sin. So am I showing a really good reflection of Jesus? Not quite. And if it gets dirtier and dirtier and dirtier, what we're then showing the world is an inaccurate picture, a distorted picture of who the one true God is. And so God's design is that we show an accurate reflection of who he is. But when we're full of sin and self, we're not showing anybody who Jesus really is. So the Lord, what his process is, do you have the paper towels, Jen? So what the Holy Spirit does each and every day with us, each and every day is this process, right? Let's see. Look at that. He's like, oh, look at this. This part. Okay, good. Yep. But you still got some areas, all right, each of us. We each got some areas that he's still working on, right? You know, and sometimes it takes a little longer because we're stubborn. We're selfish. And he's trying. He's trying, but sometimes we don't let him, right? And we got to say, all right, Lord, I surrender this part of my life to you. I don't want to do this because I know if I do this, I'm not showing the world who you are. So, Lord, do with whatever you need to do to get this out of my life, right? And so when you do that, the Holy Spirit's like, okay, I can work with you then. All right, let's do this. Look at this. Yes. You know, and listen, our life is not about being perfect. We're striving for it. We're never going to reach it. The only time we're going to reach it is when we die, we come right into God's presence where perfection is. But we're striving for it because we want to show who God is to other people. We want to show an accurate reflection. And guess what? What is the biggest complaint people have about Christians? They're hypocrites. They say one thing, they do another. You know what I mean? But guess what? I've got this standard that I'm trying to reach, and that's the Lord, and that's perfection, but I'm not going to arrive there. What is a person that's not a believer striving for? They got nothing. They got nothing they're going after, so it's easy for them to say, hey, look at you. You keep falling. You keep messing up because you're striving for perfection. You keep falling. So it's easy for them to say stuff to us because we're striving for something. The question then you can ask them is, what are you striving for? What are you striving for? Is there anything in your life that has a moral value that you're going for? Because I'm going for trying to reflect Jesus as best I can, and I fall short. When you look at a person that calls you a hypocrite, you can say, I am. I'm a hypocrite because I can't be perfect, but I'm striving. And if you see something in me that is not right, come, please tell me. Please. I want to know. Will we be willing to ask that of somebody, though? Say, I'm striving. I'm doing the best I can with the Lord's work, the Lord's help, the Lord working on me, right? I'm striving. And so engage in that conversation. Don't get mad at them for calling you a hypocrite, because guess what? We are. We're not perfect. We are going to mess up. But as long as we're striving, you can tell them that. And I'm surrendering. It's not about me achieving perfection. It's about the Lord filling me to be more like him, to show an accurate reflection to everybody else. Does that make sense? That's the point we're trying to make. If we go back to that point, it's that, what's he getting us ready for? Well, to live a life that reflects him. Look at John 16:13. If you're still there in John 16:7, he said the Holy Spirit was going to come and prove to the world that we're guilty in our sin. But I love this. You guys need to underline this or put it in your phone or something. Because this is a life verse that you can just keep going back to. It's John 16:13. But when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into what? All truth. Do you guys understand that? He's going to guide us into all truth. So if it's wrong, he's going to guide you. If it's true, he's going to guide you. He's going to show you the way for you to go, the actions you need to do. I love this verse too. You don't need to turn there. I'm just going to say it. Isaiah 30:21 says this. The bread of adversity and the water of affliction, you might experience that, yet your teachers will not be moved into a corner anymore, but your eyes shall see your teachers. And then verse 21, this is it. Your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. Whenever you turn to the right or right hand, or whenever you turn to the left, walk in it. Imagine that. If we're walking according to the Lord, we're going to hear his voice behind us going, hey, walk in it. Walk this way, turn this way, go this way. And it's like, thank you, Lord, for showing me the direction I need to go. Because that's Isaiah 30:21, if you wanted to go back and read that for yourself. Isaiah 30:21, there's a voice behind us that says, this is the way, walk in it. Now, the next point, share the good news about him. What's he getting us ready for? To share the good news about him. We can't keep Jesus locked up here in this church and us go walk out these doors, live life without Jesus all week, and know, hey, I'll show back up next Sunday and I'll unpack Jesus and we'll have our Jesus time and then we'll leave him here and we'll go back out there and we'll just keep going and living life, right? We can't do that. Jesus walks everywhere with us, right? We show that reflection. And the important thing is we need to share the good news about him. We can't just keep him locked up. 1 Peter 3:15 says, but make sure in your hearts that Christ is Lord. Always be ready to give an answer to anyone who asks you about the hope you have. Be ready to give the reason for it, but do it gently and with respect. Guys, all our lives, God's been preparing us to share about him. As we learn and grow, that's what we ultimately do. How many of you out there had a moment this past week where you could have shared Jesus with somebody? And maybe it was like, oh, I kind of felt a little shy. I didn't know how to say it. It's a process. God's going to get you through. Now, I'm going to ask Jen. I had this second chair up here for a reason, and Jen is not prepared at all. She's like, what? But I'm going to ask her to come up here. And the reason is, this is our story. Sometimes I neglect to think that you guys just know things about us, and you don't. You know, you don't know our story. Sometimes it's like we just assume that you know what our story is, and it's not. So if you don't mind, I just want to share a little bit of our story because it leads to something about this. Share the good news about Jesus. He's preparing us to be ready to give an answer to anyone who asks you about the hope you have. So Jen was born in Racine, Wisconsin. Okay, she grew up in church. Her mom and dad always taught her about Jesus. So she grew up, and she feels very blessed about that, right? I mean, I grew up in a church family. I feel like I thank God that my mom and dad taught me the ways of Jesus, so I knew that. But guess what? As you grow up, it's not your mom and dad's faith. It has to become your own decision in Jesus Christ, not just mom and dad. So I couldn't get to heaven on my mom and dad's faith. It had to become my own. And I remember as a young boy, I remember being convicted of sin. I'm like, I know I do bad things. And my dad one night was walking by the room and he said, I asked him to come in my room. I said, Dad, I feel like Jesus. I need Jesus. I need Jesus to be my Savior and my Lord. And I remember that night my dad led me to the Lord. Like, he showed me how to become a Christian. And I was so thankful for that. And even as I got into like my teenage years, things still were like, I'm just sin and selfish and all this. And there was a point that I rededicated my life to Christ. And I don't know if you guys have ever experienced that situation or scenario, but I just felt like I was, and that rededication in my life was the time that I was like, not on mom and dad's faith, but it was my own. And that was a spiritual marker in my life. And so, do you want to share briefly how you came to know the Lord? Yeah, just.
So I was a little girl. I was 4 years old, I think. And we had learned the story of David and Goliath at church. And I came home and I told my mom and dad that I wanted to be strong like David because he killed the giant. And so she said, well, he didn't do that in his own strength. He did that because of God. And so then she led me through who God is and who Jesus is and things that he... And so I gave my life to Christ when I was really little and then got baptized when I was 8. But like Tim, I think I didn't fully come to understand the intimacy I could have with Christ until I was a teenager. And I was at a camp, and I was 16, and I was the only girl in my grade that was at camp that week. And I remember one afternoon I was really lonely, and all the other kids were out doing stuff, and I was in the cabin, and I was crying, and I was like, I just want to go home. And my youth pastor's wife came in, and she asked me what was wrong, and I told her I was lonely and I didn't have a friend this week at camp. And she said, well, did you ever think that God brought you here by yourself, that he wanted to let you know that he wanted to be your best friend? And so that is the time when I felt like I really came to know Jesus as my friend and not just as my savior. And so I recommitted my life to Christ then. And that's also when I felt called to be a youth pastor's wife, when I was 16 and I knew I was going to marry a youth pastor. I didn't know who it was, but I just felt that calling on my life. From then.
Well, and so I'm fast forwarding, but part of our story, you know, we met at school in the upper levels, and we were just, you know, God brought us together, and we were reading scripture together, you know, just asking the Lord, you know, the direction. So we got married. God showed us that we need to get married. And so we did. We got married, and then we started working in the church. I was a youth pastor, children's pastor, and things like that. Well, part of our story, the hard part of our story, is that we couldn't have kids. And we didn't know why. And so, there's two ladies that I can think of in the Bible, is Sarah, and I can think of Hannah, who you know, God just closed the womb, right? And we couldn't have kids. And so we wanted that. And matter of fact, Jen's brothers and their wives, they were getting pregnant and they were having kids. And it was just like, why can't we? Like, why, Lord, right? And so it came to the point where we looked at each other and said, well, maybe we should adopt, right? It's like God knows our heart. We want to have children. And so we started adoption process. And there were some opportunities that kind of fell through that didn't work out. And each time that happened, it was like a knife to our hearts, because it was like, we want children. But it was like God saying, here's an opportunity. And it felt like he was taking it away from us. And that was hard for us to deal with in our marriage. And it was hurtful. And so we wrestled through trying to figure out God and what his plan was. And we're like, God, what are you getting us ready for? Right? We had no clue. We didn't understand. It was hard times. And so then we found an agency, and it was from China. And so we're like, okay, well, a Chinese baby. Okay, let's try this. And so we started the process, and God showed us door after open door after open door, this is what we should do. And it was going to take 2 years to get this child. And then as we're realizing in the process, it took 6 years for this process to happen. And so We were just struggling, like, why is this taking so long? So then we actually, go ahead.
I remember one day, just one short thing, that Tim said to me one day. He said, even if it's just the two of us forever, we're still a family. And so that was when my heart was like, finally, okay, I can trust the Lord, because we're still a family. You don't have to have kids to be a family, right? And the Lord just really broke me in that moment, and I was like, okay. And so then it was like the doors started to open. Yeah.
And so we just kind of constantly kept following the Lord's next step and the Lord's next step. And then all of a sudden in 2007, we find out, oh, she's pregnant. We're like, what? Okay, so all these years we couldn't have kids, and now we're in an adoption process, and our paperwork is actually sitting over on a desk in China, but now we're just waiting our turn, right? There's all these people ahead of us, and so that's what's taking 6 years, right? Well, before that 6 years happened, in the meantime, she gets pregnant, and so we have Brayden. And so now Brayden is like, yeah. And so people keep asking us at our church, and they met well. Are you still going to go through with the adoption? We're like, yeah, of course. It's like we've been pregnant with another one for a really long time. We're waiting for this child, right? You know, and it's there. We're not just going to say no, you know, to this process. And so then we're still waiting. Brayden gets to about 2 years old, you know, and we're still waiting for this process. And then Jen somehow finds out.
They passed online a law in China that you could adopt two as long as one of them was a special focus child. And that was a child with some special needs, right? And they had all these profiles online that you could look through of children. And so I said, Tim, can I start looking for another baby? Because we can have two babies. And he said, okay. So I start looking through them, and I would skip over all the Down syndrome children. That's part of our story. I have to tell you that. Okay, so this was years before Anna Joy. But when I was looking through profiles, I say, oh, that would be too hard. Can't do that. Skip over that one. Oh, I can do this little guy right here. He's two, and he has some digestive issues, and he has six toes on each foot. That's so cool. And that was little Joshua right here. I said, six toes are adorable. We can totally do that. So then we found him.
Found him online. His picture.
And so his adoption only took 9 months because he was a special needs child, and it was fast. So we went to China.
We're still waiting for the six-year one,
the
right?
The six-year, who is that child? A mystery child.
Yeah.
Non-special needs somewhere in China. Supposed to be 6 to 9 months old. And I had all my baby stuff still ready after Brayden.
So Brayden's two, and we find out we're actually going to be adopting another one. Yeah. And his name in Chinese was Jiaxian. And we thought, that sounds so close to Joshua. And so we're like, okay, let's call him Joshua, right? It's kind of close to Jiaxian, right? And when we get over there to China, now we couldn't find this out on over the internet, but when we literally got there in China, the lady that was the leader of this foster home, so she is a lady that has Chinese people helping her, and they have all these children, and they're taking care of them, and she's rescuing these kids from different situations. She has Joshua with all these other children, right? We come to find out this lady was an undercover Christian missionary. And we thought, wow, you know, and his name, Joshua, the name Joshua means the Lord saves, right? We're like, God, you are just writing this whole thing. We're just going through each step, right? We're following you, Lord. And so we bring him back home. And Brayden gets to meet Joshua. And then, literally, 3 weeks later, they call us and say, do you remember that six-year wait you've had? He's ready. And we're like, what? Okay, so we just got Joshua. And literally, 3 months later, we went back to China, and we get Micah. And Micah comes home to us. And here's where.
And then they were 3, 2, and 1, and I said, I am not ready for this.
They were 3, 2, and 1, all August birthdays. All August birthdays. And we're like, okay, Lord, you have a sense of humor, right? We're laughing. And but I want to share something with you. Yeah. Go ahead and share Anna Joy real quick. Yeah.
Just real quick then. 3 years later, the boys kept on, Brayden kept on asking for a little sister. Micah kept saying he had a sister in China somewhere. And I would say, maybe you do, I don't know. And I thought I was a great boy mom and we were good to go. And they were 7, 6, and 5 or something like that. No, 6, 5, and 4. And I said, oh, I think we're done. But then the Lord kept telling me, you're not done, there's a little one over there. And one night, I won't go into the whole story. A conversation with a friend led me to this night where I couldn't sleep. And the Lord was saying to my heart, you have a little girl in China with Down syndrome, and you need to go bring her home. And I was like, wow. And so I said the next day, I said, can I start looking for her, Tim? And he said, I told you to stay offline and stop looking for babies. And but so I went on there, and she was the first face we saw, and she was 3. And so hers only took 9 months as well. And then so then we had the 4 of them. That's all I was going to share. But the whole Down syndrome thing, it was the Lord. He had to prepare us, right? And when I kept, he took me back to that. Remember when you skipped over all those precious babies and you said you couldn't do it? Well, you're right, you can't do it. But I can do it in you and through you. And so we brought the baby, her home to her brothers.
All right, so here's where the interesting thing God showed us. When we went over to adopt Micah, we met a man named Eddie, and he was a young man, about 23 at the time, maybe 22, 23, and he was given to us as an interpreter. And we had an opportunity to go to see Micah's orphanage and see where they were raising him. And so we didn't say much when we were driving to it. It was about an hour and a half ride to the orphanage. And over there in China, you kind of want to be careful how you say you're a Christian, because there's some persecution over there in China. And so we get to the orphanage, and the president of the orphanage, vice president, all the top people come out, and they want to meet us, and they see Micah's with us and all that. Well, Eddie interpreted and said they want to know what you do in the States. And I'm like, okay. I think you just blurted out, he's a pastor. And I was like, oh boy, all right. Let's see if this is okay. Is this all right that I'm a pastor? And Eddie didn't even translate. He looked straight at us and said, are you Christians? And I was like, yes, I'm not going to say no. Yes, we are Christians. And he's like, me too. He pulls this big cross necklace out and he's like, yeah, me too. And I was like, sweet. I was like, I know what we're going to be talking about on the ride home, right? So we see Micah's orphanage and everything. Well, as I'm talking with Eddie in the back of the car on this hour and a half ride back, I said, so how did you become a believer in Jesus? And he says, well, I like Christian teachings. I like who Jesus was and all this. And I looked at him, I said, do you know, Eddie, that you can have a relationship with Jesus because of what God has done by sending Jesus to the cross? And he's like, I've never heard that before. And I'm thinking to myself, just as in most Eastern cultures have it, they like philosophy. They like the teachings. And if they like the teachings, they're going to align themselves up with that teaching. But he never realized his sins could be forgiven and that he could have a relationship with God by what Jesus did to make that happen. And so I'm realizing this, and I'm like, oh no, here comes, we're at the end of our car ride. I'm never going to see this guy again, right? I'm like, what do we do? So I give him my email. I'm like, okay, just stay in contact with me. Well, even in China, emails are screened. I mean, they see everything over there. And so I wouldn't be able to have a really good spiritual conversation with him by email. So I was kind of frustrated. But anyway, we come back to the States. I get an email from Eddie, all right? And save the picture. So I get an email from Eddie, and it blows my mind. He is in Mexico. I'm like, Eddie, you're in Mexico? I'm like, what are you doing in Mexico? He's like, I got a visa from China where I could come to Mexico and I could teach university students Chinese language. And I'm like, but you don't know Spanish. He's like, hey, yeah, that's no big deal. I'm learning it. So he is Chinese, knows English, and is learning Spanish, and he's teaching Chinese to Spanish-speaking students. I'm like, this is wild. So this is about August. And then he emails me again and says, hey, I've got a Christmas break coming up. Can I come visit you guys? And we're like, we've hardly known you for like four or five hours, and you want to come visit us up in the States. I'm like, how's a person on a visa from China in Mexico going to be able to get to the States with a passport from China? I didn't understand all that. But he said, yeah, I can come too. And so Jen and I are talking about this, like, Lord, are you doing this? What's going on here? And so we said, okay, if he can get here, we know it's of God, right? So he emails back and says, I've got my plane ticket. I'm ready to come. I'll see you guys in December. We're like, what? This is amazing. So we actually go to the airport And we're like, are we going to even be able to recognize him? You know, I was like, well, there's not going to be many Chinese people coming off the plane. So, so here he comes. He's walking down and all the boys like run up. They hug him. I mean, it's like he's already part of our family. It's really interesting. And so we're like, hey, Eddie. And so he starts sharing, things that are happening in Mexico. Well, part of our Christmas was for us to travel back to my boyhood home where I grew up. And he's like, yeah, I'll be glad to go with you guys. You know, I want to be with you guys. So we go back, and I call my parents. I'm like, you're never going to believe this story. You know, this guy is from China. Can he celebrate Christmas with us? And they're like, yeah, bring him on. You know, so my mom and dad love the Lord. And so we get to my mom and dad's house. They still have the same place. And it comes to Christmas Eve. And I know we're going to go to church Christmas Eve. And I thought to myself, maybe this will be the moment that Eddie realizes maybe could have a relationship with Jesus, because we're going to go to church on Christmas Eve. So we get in the car and it starts snowing. And we get to the top of a hill and my mom and dad call us and say, turn around. They canceled Christmas Eve services because the roads are so bad with snow. And I thought to myself, oh man, the pastor was going to preach on Jesus. He was going to show them who Jesus is. I was like, man, what's going on? So I was like, all right, Lord. So we put the kids to bed. It's late. We all gather around the kitchen table. My mom, my dad, me and Jen, I think my sister was there, my nephew was there, and we're all talking about Jesus. We're just talking about Jesus. And we explained it to Eddie. How do you become a believer? You got to trust Jesus as your Savior and Lord. And my mom, she looks at Eddie and says, Eddie, is there any reason why you wouldn't want to become a Christian right here and now? And Eddie's like, I can't think of any reason why not to. Yeah, I do. I want to become a believer. And at the kitchen table where I grew up eating my meals, a stranger from China is accepting Christ as his Savior, all because we were willing to wait 6 years for an adoption because we couldn't have kids. I mean, I'm like, Lord, this is unbelievable. And he prays, and we look up at the clock, and it's past midnight. It's Christmas Day. I think this is what Jesus came for, to show people how they need him. And if we sit back and we don't tell people, it's like we're keeping all that for ourselves. Let me show you a picture of Eddie. This is Eddie right here. Up here on the right-hand side, that's Eddie. And he's almost like an adopted son to us. Older son, right? And Eddie, just to even blow your mind a little more, 2 years after that, he's still in Mexico. Our church took a mission trip to Mexico, and Eddie said, can I come up and join you guys? He took a bus 12 hours, came up, joined us, and was helping us interpret to Spanish-speaking. He is Chinese, and he's helping us with English to Spanish on a mission trip because God got a hold of his life. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. It's amazing. God writes your story. But the whole point of that whole thing is he's getting us ready to share the good news about Jesus. And so always be ready to give an answer to anyone who asks you about the hope you have. Here's God's plan. God's plan is this: to keep us growing and going. Does that make sense? He wants us to grow in his word. As we're reading his word, as we're worshiping together, as we're praying, he wants us to grow in him. But he doesn't want us to grow. He just wants us to go as well and tell others about the hope that we have. But what's he getting us ready for? Here it is. How good does it feel when you finish all the preparation and you see this work of art that you've completed or this job that you fixed, or this meal that you've prepared. How good does that feel? Here it is. He's getting us ready for joining him face to face. God did all this preparing for us one day to be face to face with him. That's the hope that we have. We don't have hope or just discouragement or meaningless when we die, there's nothing left. We have hope that we're hit with him. And that's what he's getting us prepared for, is to meet him face to face. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it weren't so, what I had told you, I go to prepare a place for you. Here he is. Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, and that where I am, you may be also. So look at this verse. 1 Peter 1:13 says, so prepare your minds for action. Control yourselves. Put your hope completely in the grace that will be given to you when Jesus Christ returns. That's going to be a great day. When we see Jesus face to face, we're just going to sense his grace and forgiveness. Think about Noah. In Hebrews 11, verse 7, it says, Noah had faith, so he built an ark to save his family. He built it because of his great respect for God. God had warned him about these things that could not yet be seen. Because of his faith, he showed the world that it was guilty. Because of his faith, he was considered right with God. Think about that. Noah, he had a lot of preparing to do for a big old storm. And God gave him all the details right along the way to get prepared. What is God getting ready for us to do? Will you allow him to work in your life so you can do his will? But you say, Tim, I can't do that. I can't do this. I don't know if I could do that. Oh, man. The little boy had two fish and five loaves of bread, right? And he brought the little thing to Jesus. When you bring what little you have to Jesus, watch what he will do from that point on. Don't say it's too little or I can't do this. He can do it. He can do it through you. So as we close today, I just want us to think about, if you're here today and you don't know if you're a believer, you could probably say, Tim, I know I'm not a Christian. I've never accepted Christ and the forgiveness of God for my sin. I pray today that you would make that decision. It's the best decision you'll ever make in your life. I thought the best decision was my wife. Mm-mm. No, the greatest decision is what will last forever, and that's eternity. And that's what we're going to learn about these next weeks of Christmas. We're going to learn about the names of Jesus. Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, the Great I Am. These names of Jesus. It's him. And that's what we should reflect to people, is Jesus. It's all about him. So in part two of the messages on preparations, we're going to see all that went into the preparations for Jesus to come here. And so I pray that if you're here and you can say, yeah, Tim, I'm a believer. I've been saved by grace through faith. I'm just not walking it. I'm not living it. I'm not living that reflection life. I pray today that during this next song, that you would just take time with just you and God, and you would pray, and that you would let him talk to you. Let him convict you. Let him show you the things in your life that you need to get rid of, and allow him to clean in you, because it's a process. It's a process. So let's pray together, and then we'll sing one last song. God, thank you so much for this day, Lord. Thank you for us being in a season of preparation. We're always being prepared for you, Lord. And so, God, I pray that you would just allow us opportunity to share who you are, and that you would help us live the right way, the way we should, to make you happy, to make you smile. It's all about you. And Lord, every day we've got to say no to sin and selfishness. And so help us to do that, Lord, as we go from here, Lord, help us to be those missionaries you've called us to be. I pray, God, that if there's somebody here today that hasn't accepted you as Savior, that today would be the day of their salvation, that they could look back on their life and say, November 27th, I made it right with God. and I accepted his forgiveness. I accepted Jesus as Savior of my Lord. God, I thank you so much again for this time that we've had together. And we love you, Lord. And in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.